morning, church. I couldn't speak until the cord went away. No matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. And I wish we could welcome you all. Jason was just singing a song this morning that he might sing in a couple of weeks because we miss you all so much. I am joined this morning by Jason, who's at the piano and will be playing the guitar a little bit later. Mitch is at the controls. Thank you, Mitch. And Vince is in the back doing everything else that needs to be taken care of so that all can be smooth in these live streams that come to you while you're in your pajamas, in your comfy chairs. I know you are. Okay. I have some announcements this morning. One is that we are, I think it's rather apparent, we are done with Holden prayer outside on the front lawn on Wednesday evenings. So until such time as we get back to decent weather, which probably won't be until what, next July? We'll probably not be able to do that together. Today, we're going to talk about it in just a moment. We're having a big Halloween extravaganza, a drive-through Halloween fun time in the parking lot of our church here. Come, it's from 4 to 5. Kids can wear costumes and they can get out of their cars and we can all wave at them. There'll be bags of treats and I hope we'll have some hot cider for everybody. So it'll be a good time to be able to at least wave at each other across the parking lot. We invite you today to bring ICA donations for Thanksgiving. They're looking for those things that you would make in a typical Thanksgiving dinner, canned cranberries, pumpkin. And if you would like to donate a turkey, you can get a voucher for $20. That's available from Sherry or Ray, and you can call the office and donate that, and that would be great. Another thing you can donate today or anytime you wish is warm wear for Resource West. At this time of the year, when the weather turns cold, we gather up our gently used coats and ski pants for kids. Anything you have that someone might be able to use, you can donate new things, or money is always accepted too. Our front doors can be opened in the morning from about 7 to 9. Mis Amigos is here meeting the parents as the kids come, so you can drop your donations off right there in the vestibule. Next week is All Saints Day. It's the first day of November. I want to remind you that it's daylight savings time, so you'll have an extra hour of sleeping. But as we have done in years past, we have a box that we can put candles in, and we can put candles for each of those loved ones who we remember on that day. So if you have loved ones that you would like to light candles for, please call the office or send me or Char an email and let us know. You can give their names, but you don't need to. You can just say for my mother, Mary, or whatever. And we will be lighting those candles during the service next week. Let's look at our calendar for this week. Today, as I said, from 4 to 5, we have our Halloween gathering drive-through. Wednesday morning is aha moments, and any of these things that are on Zoom, you can go to the calendar on our webpage, which you'll see there at the bottom of the slide, and you will find the Zoom link right there on the calendar page. On Wednesday evening at 7 o'clock, we have choir via Zoom. The choir is going to be having a song that we are going to be able to watch next week, November 1st on All Saints Day. And then next week, of course, we come back to live worship on YouTube. Thank you. Let's go to the next slide, which is join us for the Halloween gathering. There's a bunch of scary pumpkins there, and I hope you can wear your scary costume if you like. We ask everybody to wear a mask, of course, and all kids are invited, whether or not you are connected with the church. If your neighbors want to come, that would be great. Invite them along. We've left out flyers for all the Mis Amigos parents, so who knows who will come, but it's sure to be a good time, and there'll be more than three people in the same place at the same time. That will be amazing for all of us. Okay, now I want to talk a little bit about our giving drive, and our treasurer Mary has put together each week some informational slides for you. So let's look at those for this week. Help us turn our dreams into realities. Great things are just on the horizon for Spirit of Peace. And this morning, we share some of the plans we have for the upcoming 2021 budget. We want to celebrate who we were, who we are, and who we are becoming. And we will set aside some funds to party with and let the world know that we're here. We will donate equally to each of our denomination's ministries. We plan to increase the salaries of our staff, and we are working to lower our building and office expenses by at least $20,000. That is something Mary has committed to. So I pray that that will happen as smoothly as I think she believes it's going to happen. So that's great. Okay, at least 20% of our budget will be allocated for outreach and social justice. Some of the ministries we are considering is disaster relief, climate change, immigration and racial justice issues on a national and international level, and on a local level as well. And ICA, Resource West, Sojourners, and Our Savior's housing in our local community. We are thinking that each month we will have one of those ministries as a donation and as an vehicle for us to learn more about what those ministries do. How can we expand the use of our lovely building? This is God's space. We want to listen and be open to the many needs beyond our doors. We all look forward to when we can be physically back together in 2021. But in the meantime, we need your support so that we can continue to reach out and assist others in these difficult times. Please be prayerful and thoughtful about sharing your family's abundance with Spirit of Peace in 2021. We are blessed to be a blessing for others. And now, we've had a lot of announcements and a lot of things kind of running around in our heads, and now it's time to just take a few moments to fully arrive. We do that so infrequently in our lives, where we completely show up with all of our focus and all of our being in one place in order to be open and receive what the Holy would have us learn. So I invite you to put your feet flat on the floor, put your hands relaxed in your lap or however they feel most comfortable, and take some deep breaths in. I love that Thich Nhat Hanh meditation. I think we did it last week, and I would love to do it again. And it goes like this: breathing in, I calm body and soul. Breathing out, I smile. So let's do that. Take a deep breath. Breathing in, I calm body and soul. Breathing out, I smile. Breathing in, I calm body and soul. Breathing out, I smile. Breathing in, I calm body and soul. Breathing out, I smile. A path, though it winds its way through darkness, we would choose to avoid it if we could. We awake to an unexpected calling. God says, come, there are gifts in the dark. The gift of temptation may bring images of resisting evil, sometimes in seriously dangerous forms or as seemingly benign as the pastry right in front of you. But instead, the temptation for this week is when we follow the shoulds dictated only by logic or outside expectation or the shiny rewards, instead of following the path our intuition and our imagination suggest is the right one for us, the path that helps us bring the best of our energy and joy to the world. Our Darkwood journey invites us to face the temptations that erode our fullness and steal us away from our wholeheartedness. There's a path, though it winds its way through darkness, we would choose to avoid it if we could. We awake to an unexpected calling. God says, come. There are gifts in the dark. Unexpected love, enter our lives and open us to the gifts residing deep within the holy darkness of our lives. Open us to seek your voice from deep within, for we yearn to feel you moving in us. In your many names, we pray. Amen. Our opening song this morning is one I've always loved, The Spirit of Gentleness. Spirit, Spirit of gentleness, blow through the wilderness, calling and free. Spirit, Spirit of restlessness, stir me from placidness, wind on the sea. You moved on the waters, you called to the deep. Then you coaxed up the mountains from the valleys of sleep. And over the eons, you called to each thing. Awake from your slumbers and rise on your wings. Spirit, Spirit of gentleness, blow through the wilderness, calling and free. Spirit, Spirit of restlessness, stir me from placidness, wind on the sea. You sang in a stable, you strung on the hill. Then you whispered in silence, so when the whole world was still. And down in the city, you called once again. When you blew through your people on the rush of the wind. Spirit, Spirit of gentleness, all through the wilderness, calling and free. Spirit, Spirit of restlessness, stir me from placidness, wind on the sea. You call from tomorrow, you break ancient schemes. From the bondage of sorrow, all the captives dream dreams. Our women see visions, our men clear their eyes. With bold new decisions, your people arise. Spirit, Spirit of gentleness, blow through the wilderness, calling and free. Spirit, Spirit of restlessness, stir me from placidness, wind, wind on the sea. A prayer of acknowledgement is for us to just be open and deliberate about acknowledging some of the things that we do or fail to do in our lives. Let's pray it together. For paying more attention to the expected path than the right one, forgive and restore us, O God. For denying our very aliveness out of a misguided, self-sacrificing agenda, forgive and restore us, O God. For valuing the safe choices instead of the ones that lead to life, forgive and restore us, O God. Hear these words of God's assurance. God desires our fully alive selves. God is cheering us on as we discern best choices. God is with you, forgiving and restoring you to wholeheartedness. Thanks be to God. Amen. Now, wherever you are, I would invite you to offer the peace of Christ to those who are around you. If you are alone, and many of us are at home alone these days, you can just pass the peace of Christ from your heart out into the world and to all those loved ones who you miss so much. Spirit of peace to you, Jason. Spirit of peace to you, Mitch, and to Vince. I'm going to read a couple of the messages that have come up this morning. Willie says, let it snow, let it snow, let it snow. Okay, Willie, thank you. Deb says, good morning. Dick and Deb are here. Blessings to all. Blessings to all from Mary and Tricia, and good morning from Randy and Deb. Dick F. says, excellent budget plans. Agreed completely. Wally says, good morning, everyone. Linda says, a prayer of gratitude that my grandson does not have COVID. That is a very good thing. And Ray says, hello from Lois. A brisk good morning from Lois and Ray. I think we'll go to our song this morning. I'm going to read a couple of things. Bookended by a really beautiful song, Open Our Eyes. We've sung it in our worship before.
Open our eyes, Lord. Help us to see your face. Open our eyes, Lord. Help us to see.
This is from 1 Corinthians 5, verses 16 through 19. From now on, therefore, we regard no one from a human point of view. Even though we once knew Christ from a human point of view, we know him no longer in that way. So if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to God's self, not counting our errors against us, and entrusting the reconciliation message to us.
Open our ears, Lord. Help us to hear your voice. Open our ears, Lord. Help us to hear.
This is a reading that is out of the book we're using for this series. The book is called Gifts of the Dark Wood, and it's by the Reverend Eric Elness. He writes, the Spirit beckons us not to be good, but to be human, humble, of the humus, which ultimately means finding your elemental waters, which are connected to God, and living into your fullest energies. You can and will do a lot of good by walking the path that brings you most fully alive in this world. But in order to stay on this path, you must learn to say no to doing a great many good things.
Open our hearts, Lord. Help us to love like you. Open our hearts, Lord. Help us to love.
Please pray with me. May there be more of you and less of me. More of you and less of me. More of you and less of me. Amen. We have been spending a fair number of weeks now talking about what Dante called the dark wood. Now, when I considered doing this series, I knew it was fitting for such a time as this because of all the sheer weirdness in our world right now. We are in a head-shaking time for sure, and there is not a one of us that has not been affected by the disorientation and the aberrations of our time. I am grateful for the Reverend Eric Elness, who wrote this book, because I am personally finding it very comforting and practical and grounding to find a way to look at the abundant challenges that we are encountering in the dark wood as gifts. So far, we've explored the very unlikely gifts of uncertainty, of being empty, of being thunderstruck, and getting lost. These are gifts because as obstacles on our path, they ask us to expand our awareness of the habits or the attitudes that might be tripping us up. We would do well to examine these fully without fear or reluctance, and that is doubly true of the gift we are exploring today. To engage bravely with it will open new realms of understanding and opportunity for us. At the same time, this gift is very sneaky and sly, and it can undo us if we are not careful. In fact, the challenge of this gift is so great that Jesus struggled with it too. We are talking about the gift of temptation. Now, temptation is a word that's laden with heavy implications, so let's throw out the meanings that we're not talking about. We're not talking about holding up a bank, or extreme tax cheating, or indulging the fantasy of having an ejector button for that nasty one who cut you off in traffic. We're not even talking about buying an extra bag of Halloween treats and stashing it in a secret hiding place away from everyone else in your household. No. We are talking about the temptation to do good. Because I know that many of us, while we have overindulged in chocolate or Ripple chips and dip, in my case, a few more times than we'd like, we aren't really tempted to play out any of those more dire or obviously bad actions or crimes. While we might entertain kind of amusing and brief fantasies of evil deeds, like doing away with the raccoons that are raiding our bird feeder, doing them is not really a significant temptation. No, we are much more likely to succumb to the lure of doing good. Of course, doing good is not itself the issue, but doing the wrong good might be. And by wrong good, I mean any good work that is not yours to do. It's for someone to do that good, but it's not your calling. In talking about this gift, the Reverend Elness uses the story of Jesus' temptation in the wilderness. Now, that's the story that usually marks the beginning of Lent, and it tells about the beginning of Jesus' public ministry. before he began, Jesus is guided by the Spirit to go out into the wilderness to prepare his heart and his soul and his mind for his true calling, the good work he would take up. That 40 days in the wilderness was a time of testing, of temptation. The biblical narrative includes a character, Satan, who is the personification of temptation. Now, Satan comes from the Hebrew Satan, meaning adversary. In his book, Elnaz reframes the interplay between the adversary and Jesus as an exchange that presents not blatant bad temptations, but ideas that actually could be, in one sense, good. For example, Jesus, deep into his long fast, is very hungry, and the adversary says, "Why don't you turn this stone into bread?" Now, it may be a temptation for Jesus to do that and then to eat and satisfy his pangs. But could it be that the adversary was suggesting that Jesus had the power and ability to feed the world? Turning stones into bread could have fed multitudes of hungry people, and that would be a very good thing, feeding the world. The adversary showed Jesus all the kingdoms and the cities of the world and claimed all of them would belong to him if he just bowed down to the adversary. Can you imagine the good that could come with a few well-chosen law changes or directives about public and private resources? Wouldn't it be a good thing to be in a position that could readily lead to world peace? Then the adversary took Jesus to the highest point of the temple in Jerusalem and challenged him to jump off and let the angels save him. Wouldn't such a blatant display of a miracle convince the world of Jesus' power and knowledge? Wouldn't that be a good thing to demonstrate? You could cut to the chase and gather disciples much more quickly, and everyone would know you truly were powerful and of God. But we know Jesus did not yield to any of those temptations, even though great good might have come from them. Jesus did feed the hungry, though. He did change the political situation. He did perform astonishing miracles. But Jesus' true purpose was not any of those good things of feeding people or challenging politics or performing miracles. Though each of those was a good part of his ministry, what he was most called to do was to live into his full humanness. He was called to wholeheartedly live into his human identity, in order to call us to live into our full human identities as children of the loving, amazing God. Elnaz writes about a friend of his who notes the question should not really be, "Are you saved?" but, "Are you used? Have you given yourself over to the Spirit so that you can be led to discover your fullest life?" Sometimes we mistakenly believe that good means to be self-sacrificing. And so we end up on a path that ignores our deepest yearnings, never realizing that the Holy has placed those yearnings in us to steer us along on the right path. When our scriptures say we become a new creation, they mean yielding to God's intention for us, so that we can find our way to our greatest wholehearted aliveness. So I'm going to give you an example from my own life. As a lot of you know, I spent many years in theater. I love that world, especially musical theater and opera. For years, it wasn't a dark wood for me at all, but a sunlit path that just opened up all kinds of possibilities. I had been fortunate to be selected for the chorus of many Minnesota Opera Productions. And then one day out of the blue, I was asked to audition for a small Gilbert and Sullivan company that I'd never heard of. I got the part, and I loved the experience. I offered to do the choreography for another GNS production, one I was also performing in. And when the director bizarrely dropped out just 3 weeks before opening, I was asked to step in as the director. I had never directed anything before or even considered it, but now I jumped in wholeheartedly and found I was pretty good at it. I had a lot of experience, dozens and dozens of productions, so I knew something about it. This led to my directing other shows with the Gilbert and Sullivan Company, and then branching out, I choreographed a production for the Minnesota Opera and was asked to direct a smaller scale one-act opera they were doing as part of an experiment in expanding their audiences. Then I was offered another wonderful opportunity to be the assistant director for Minnesota Opera's main stage production, Tales of Hoffman. This was an amazing and remarkable chance for me. The opera company at the time, like many companies, would double cast the leading roles because opera singers sing full voiced for several hours in a performance without a microphone over a full orchestra. They need at least a day between performances to rest. It's not, though, economical for a theater like the Ordway to just be unused every other day while you wait for your stars to recover, hence the double casting. The chorus and the supporting roles are the same, but in this case, there were two sets of four leading singers who alternated performances. As the assistant director, it was my job to work with the B cast. This meant that the A cast and all the other singers and actors rehearsed in the giant rehearsal room, the one with the sets and all, and the four leading singers in the B cast came to the studio where I was with an accompanist, and we were all by ourselves in there, somewhere else in the building. I have to tell you that the last intense week of rehearsals for Tales of Hoffman with the B-cast was one of the most wonderful experiences I think I've ever had in my life. The opera's story is about the real-life writer E.T.A. Hoffman, who wrote dark and rather eerie stories. The opera tells three of these odd tales, and the four leading singers play different parts in each of the three stories. In addition, they each play a different role in the framing story that is at the beginning and end of the opera, where young Hoffman is drinking in a tavern with his friends and holding them spellbound by his compelling tales. The music is beautiful in the opera, but extremely demanding, and playing four different complicated characters in each performance draws deeply on the performer's acting abilities. It was a great privilege and a thrill to work with these extraordinary talents and explore their characters and acting choices with them. Every day I was stimulated to bring my best self to the work. I will never forget it. After that experience, I considered diving more fully into opera directing. It was good work, satisfying in so many ways. And yet, the next steps would have meant more travel, and with small children at home, I wasn't sure I wanted that kind of commitment. But even if I had, there was this little niggling feeling deep in my soul. It gloried in all the fascinating tasks of delving into the histories and motivations and choices of those fictional characters. It was engrossing and wonderful, but it wasn't real. It wasn't life that is really life. And I started to feel that I was being called to a deeper emotional and spiritual truth, and I wanted to explore that with people. My work with the opera was good work, to be sure, very, very good work, but it turned out it wasn't my good work. So I set off into the dark wood, feeling uncertainty for sure, and thunderstruck at all that I had discovered. Music and singing had meant so much for me. It's one of the paths that opened my spirit in the first place. But I was ready to move to a different calling, a different good. Now, I realize I've been talking about the temptation to do good in a vocation or professional sense, and that's a major area for us to think about. But maybe you're retired or settled in your vocation right now, and this is not a useful area for you to consider. So maybe you think that this message today isn't for you. But I want you to consider this. I think that virtually every day there are hundreds of little temptations urging us to choose the good over who we are. Choose one kind of good over what our gut tells us. Choose a particular good that is someone else's good over the good that is just for us. It's an interesting thought to consider how a temptation of good could lead us astray. And yet it does. And I feel pretty confident that a lot of you have experienced that in your life. You were following the good when the good turned out not to be the path for you. Good is good, but it's important to find the good that is yours. That is what the amazing love of our God does. It is there supporting us, holding us, leading us to the good that we are called to do. Amen. Now, Jason's going to sing a song about God's amazing love. It's called Your Love is Amazing.
Your love is amazing, steady and unchanging. Your love is a mountain firm beneath my feet. Your love is a mystery, how you gently lift me. When I am surrounded, your love carries me.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing.
Your love is surprising. I can feel it rising. All the joy that's growing deep inside of me. Every time I see you, all your goodness shines through. I can feel this God song rising up in me.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing. Hallelujah.
When we find that good that is ours, our hearts do truly sing. Thank you, Jason.
Come and listen. lay the fullness of your lives before the Maker.
There are many people who are walking in the dark wood, and they are there for many different reasons. Let us lift up the names of some of those right now who need our special prayers. We lift up a prayer of gratitude for Lil, who is home from the hospital, and we pray for continued healing for Lil and for Howard as they recover. We pray for Greta, Chris J's nephew's child, who is recovering from surgery. She is such a tiny little girl, and she and her twin Clara have been through so much together. We pray for healing for both of them and for continued support for their families. I lift up Christopher, Janet's nephew-in-law, as he is still recovering from his brain tumor surgery. We lift up our country this morning and all the unsettled situations and tensions, and we pray for the safety of all as they go to vote in this country. And we pray for patience for everyone, all of us, settling deep in our hearts, filled with love, as we look out at a world that needs so much of our love and concern. We pray for Linda's grandson, so grateful that he did not show COVID today. I know that everybody has particular people in their hearts that they are concerned or worried for, and right now, in the silence of your heart, or aloud if you would like, just mention those names of your beautiful friends and relatives who need God's special care. I pray too this day that you will take the time to lift up your own needs. Ask the Holy One where you have done the good that isn't yours to do, so that you can let that go in order to find that calling that is truly yours. You will know, because your heart will sing when you find that. Ask God to help you find that beauty in your heart. We pray this day too for our church, on the cusp of this shared ministry, this joining, and all the changes and decisions that come with it all. We are so grateful to the Holy One for guiding us so far, and we are in need of finding direction as we move forward. I give great thanks for everyone working so hard to bring our ministry together. Holy living God, unexpected love, we give you thanks for the gift of community. All of us journeying together, holding one another, and urging each other to find that good that is theirs to do. We are grateful to explore the gifts of the dark woods. Come and rest. Come and listen. Lay the fullness of your lives before your Maker. Come and rest. Come and listen. Lay the fullness of your lives before the Maker. We pray for all those who feel alone on their journey. Open us to be the hands of Jesus, reaching out always to our friends and neighbors around. And we pray this in his name, offering the words of his prayer. We pray together. God, heart of the world, revealed through every aspect of creation and understood through our awareness, may we honor the holiness of creation and act accordingly so that your love is reflected in the way that we live. May we always be thankful for the food we eat and the friends that we have. May we forgive those who transgress against us and be forgiven for our own weaknesses. In the freedom of love, may we live as your heartbeat and not be compromised by hesitation. Through our freedom, may your justice be seen and heard and experienced forever and ever. Amen. As we have been talking about, we are in the midst of a giving drive.
Let all things know living a song of thanksgiving to God the Creator triumphantly raise.
As part of this drive, we are asking people to make a little video or say some words about why they give. And this morning, we are honored to have Vince share with us his story of why he gives.
Why do I give? I always appreciate being asked a question like this because it forces me to think seriously and better understand how I actually feel about it myself. As I began thinking, it became clear that why, how much, my role, and the role played by the church are inextricably intertwined. The church itself fulfills many roles for many people. I've never expected to participate in all those roles, at least not all at once. As my life has journeyed through varying phases and roles, the church has also fulfilled varying roles. I'll reflect on three phases of my life. The younger years phase. As a small town farm kid in the 50s and 60s, I grew up with the churches being the anchors of the community. In many ways, that world was divided into churchgoers and non-churchgoers. I thought of the church support and involvement as part of my community responsibility. In that vein, I gave my time, volunteered, for many youth activities and leadership roles, and gave financially because I also saw that as a responsibility. I did the math and attempted to give what I computed as a high school student's fair share of what it takes to keep the church going. The next phase is family with children. Later, after graduating college, after joining St. Paul's and having children, it became very important to me to surround my children with people of good moral character and good role models and to have help teaching them. The role of the church as family and teacher became very important. I was giving not only to keep the church going, but also to assure that it had the resources to teach my children and maintain a healthy community. I gave them my time and talents in both congregational leadership and ministry leadership. At that time, the ELCA promoted tithing and encouraged trying to work toward a tithe with a 1% annual increase. At that time, I was basically giving out of scarcity. I gave what I believed to be generously from what was left after covering family expenses. I supported the concept of working toward a tithe, but never had an expectation that I would meet that goal. The mature phase. I entered the mature phase after my children became independent economic units. I started thinking more about the impact of my life, the things I say and do, and how they can change the world. I believe in working toward improving the world around me by the decisions I make every day. But the world around me is so small and the need is so great. The church addresses needs of the world in so many ways, ranging from the hope offered to the local community by and through our shared ministry, to world initiatives such as Lutheran World Relief. As the years have passed, I can't tell you how many times I thought, if the church only had this much more money, they could help the world in that way. And I gave a little more. That tithe thing, I never thought of it again, but years later I found myself shocked when I looked at the numbers and determined that I was giving far more than a tithe. I no longer give to the church because it's my responsibility. I no longer give to the church because I need it to have resources for me to consume. I give it to the church because the church is changing the world, and I want to be a part of that in my own small way. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Vince. And thank you for stopping during one of your long bike rides when the leaves were still fully beautiful. Thank you so much. Let us say together our prayer of dedication. When we give, we say yes to something we value. With these gifts, which we have gratefully received and freely given, we say yes to the values of our faith. We dedicate these gifts to God's shalom and to the vision we are shaping of our shared ministry. Holy One, use these gifts and use our hearts to make the world whole. Amen. As our last song today, we're doing something that I just found recently, and I found it on a website called Many Voices. It is a black church movement for gay and transgender justice. It says, as a black church movement for gay and transgender justice, we envision a community that embraces the diversity of the human family and ensures that all are treated with love, compassion, and justice. I would urge you to go to that website and just check it out and maybe donate. They do some wonderful work. It's manyvoices.org. And also on this website is a number of songs that are written specifically for this. And we're going to do one this morning by a man named Thu Elliott. Says he is a composer, teacher, pianist, and singer living and working in Washington, D.C. Here's what he says. Hymns are a place where our communal experience is simultaneously expressed and formed. As gathering communities work to create a more explicit welcome for those who have been disenfranchised, we need new words, new tunes. This need goads and inspires me. That is good work that he has found to do. And we are going to sing one of the songs he has made available for us. It's called Spirit, I Have Heard You Calling.
Spirit, I have heard you calling, like a memory long grown dim, crying from creation's moment, seeking voice from deep within. I have heard you in my longing. I have heard you in my pain. Now I feel you moving in me. Feel you burning like a flame. Since you know all around me, now I hear you call my name. Now I speak the feed creation's flame. Now your love defines my longing. Now your love shines through my pain. Now we dance in endless union, singing out creation's name.
You have a place in this world. a place where everything comes together in your body and you disappear into a seamless whole. In this coming week, I urge you to find a new understanding of the good that you are given to do. Do that with a sense of humility and letting go so that you may take up a new life, one that allows you to inhabit this world to your fullest self. May the Spirit of the living God, made known to us most fully within life's dark wood, go before you to show the way, go above you to watch over you, go behind you to push you into places you may not necessarily go yourself, go beneath you to uphold and uplift you, go beside you as your strong and constant companion, and dwell within you to remind you that you are surely not alone. You are loved, loved beyond your wildest imagination. And may the fire of God's blessing burn brightly upon you and within you now and always. There's a path, and it leads us out together to the wood. Where the darkness hovers still, we are sent. And the Spirit goes before us. God says, go. Be my presence in the world. Be in the spirit of peace, now and forever. Amen.